Okay. Hello, everybody. Good morning. My name is Akin Ogunoike. Okay, today, as is custom to us, we do this webinar monthly. At the end of the month, we hold this session once monthly, where we have discuss on educative issues, things that relate to healthcare practice in Nigeria. And today we are even widening up the topic to give a little bit of interest to patients, end users, individuals, things that we can easily learn from, things that you can pick that can affect our life decisions and well-being. And because of that, we have this interesting topic to talk about today: preventive medicine in healthcare. So today I'll be talking, and along with me I have Betty, that will also join me, co-facilitate the session with me. So I will start with the session and she will take over from me shortly after. So without much ado, let me first quickly welcome people that have joined us. I want to welcome Beams, I'm not sure I got the name well. Odu Betty SlickyLie@gmail.com. Thanks for joining. So this webinar is meant to be for August, but we have to push it to the first week in September. So without wasting much time, let me introduce myself once again. My name is Akin Ogunoike, Head of Sales Growth for RXO. I'm a pharmacist by profession. I've worked for roughly about 12 years, majorly in the pharmaceutical industry sector, marketing and sales of pharmaceutical products. And now I'm with RXO. Today I'll be talking a little bit on what we've come to learn and what we want to understand about the importance of taking care of our health, importance of being proactive with our health, and also being able to advise our clients properly when they come to us, when they visit a pharmacy or healthcare facility. So today, I'll be talking briefly on preventive medicine in healthcare before I hand over to Betty. Okay, think I can just start. Please, if you have if at any break in transmission, if you can wave to me so that I will just be able to respond to that. So today we'll be talking about the definition. We'll talk about preventive medicine in healthcare, the levels of preventive medicine, leading causes of preventive deaths, and lastly, preventive care. So what is preventive medicine? Preventive healthcare actually consists of measures that are taken for disease prevention. And the goal of preventive medicine is basically to promote health and well-being. So that's the focus: promote health and well-being. And secondly, to prevent three important diseases, the disease conditions, prevent disability and death. And these diseases and disability are actually affected by environmental factors, genetic predisposition, disease agents, and lifestyle choices. So those are the major triggers that we also look at in the subsequent slides. So we need to remember this: the goal of preventive medicine is to promote health and well-being, and secondly, to prevent disease, disability, and death. As once said by Benjamin Franklin, he said that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. That shows that it is more expensive to focus on therapeutic medicine than and preventive medicine. Some people see it when we consider preventive medicine, some people do not really value it. They think that I'm feeling well, I'm doing good, I don't need to take any extra measure in maintaining my well-being. And they see opportunities to spend just some bits of fun, just a little bit of money in going for regular checkups, taking supplements that will help to boost their immunity as expensive. But the point we're trying to make today is that it is actually more expensive to focus on therapeutic medicine than preventive medicine. So what are the levels of preventive medicine? There are five. I'll start with the first one, the primal and primordial prevention. These are measures that are designed to avoid development of risk factors in the first place early in life. So there are measures that helps to mitigate or reduce risk factors that will come up in life due to a genetic makeup of the patient and predisposition to hereditary diseases like chronic disorders. So these are steps that are taken to ensure that these are prevented early in life. And secondly, we have the primary prevention, which are methods to avoid occurrence of disease either through elimination of disease agent or increasing the resistance of the patient to the disease this condition. Example of this is immunization. We have patients that will boost their immunity, taking vaccines, helps to build immunity of the patients that even on further exposure to the disease-causing agent, the individual is fortified and protected, immune from the outcome of the disease agent, causative agent. And thirdly, we have secondary prevention, which are methods to detect, address, an existing disease prior to the appearance of symptoms. So there are possibilities that people already, there's already a disease condition, but symptoms are not visible yet. And that's why it is important to actually run through checks, do diagnosis checks periodically to help to detect such conditions and help to ameliorate it and ensure that it is headed on time, and then there's no level of degradation that will result in death. Example of this, we have cancer. We have patients already having elevated blood pressure. And fourthly, there is tertiary prevention, which are methods to reduce harm of symptomatic disease, such as disability or death. And these are measures that are taken to reduce the harm. A patient has already come down with a particular disease condition, and to whether to therapeutic medicine. Measures are taken to ensure that there is no, the level of disorder or disease condition is actually stopped and halted and not allowed to degrade or lead to deterioration. Examples include surgical procedures that halt spread and progression of disease. And lastly, we have the quaternary prevention, which are methods to mitigate or avoid result of unnecessary or excessive intervention in health system. It's also known that there is possibility of taking extra measures to treat patients through therapeutic means that will end up adding more harm to the patient. So these are methods to only mitigate those actions and also reduce the unnecessary excessive interventions by healthcare team. So going now into preventable deaths, because I've mentioned the three D's: disease condition, disability, and death. And most of them actually end up leading to death. So there are statistics that show some deaths that can actually be prevented. We have chronic diseases that are leading causes of death and disability. 70% of annual deaths are actually due to these chronic disorders. Chronic disorders like diabetes, lung cancer, and the rest. So we have a lot of issues that a lot of deaths that are actually that can be prevented. And 70% of these annual deaths are due to chronic disorders. Thirdly, these preventable conditions are not only compromise quality of life, they also add to rising healthcare costs. And that's related to what I said earlier. So 75% of our healthcare dollars are devoted to treat. That shows that it's to treating chronic disorders. But this can actually be prevented even before we have the symptoms displayed by the patients. And among adults aged 20 to 74, diabetes remains the leading cause of kidney failure, blindness, and non-traumatic lower extremity amputations. That's according to the CDC report. Now, What are the leading causes of preventable death? We have the cardiovascular disease, we have the chronic respiratory disease, we have the unintentional injuries. That's why it's important to be careful, take extra measures, especially using heavy machines, using heavy equipment, and even while driving, it's very important to be careful and not expose ourselves to any form of disability. Okay, just to confirm that we are home. Yeah. Okay, so we have diabetes, very, very strong, important chronic disorder that leads to death, infectious diseases, STDs, and the rest, poor diet, and sedentary lifestyle. These are leading causes of death that are actually preventable. And according to DCPN and WHO, hypertension leads the table here of number of deaths resulting from hypertension. We have per year, we have about 7.8 million from hypertension, 5.4 from smoking, tobacco, malnutrition, 3.8, STDs, 3 million. Poor diet, and we can see the list that it goes down. Poor diet, overweight or obesity, physical inactivity, alcohol intake, from solid fuels and not safe, water and poor. These are and risk factors that could actually be prevented. And we can see number of deaths that this produce yearly. This is massive. And according to IHME, this also showed the report from 2017. Number of death caused globally. You can see from that chart that number one is cardiovascular disorders. 17.79 million people died from cardiovascular disease. Cancer is number two with 9.56 million, followed by respiratory diseases with 3.9 million deaths caused by respiratory disorders. Lower respiratory infections too is also leading 2.56, dementia, digestive diseases, neonatal disorders, and the list goes on. We can see some of these can be prevented, some of these can be avoided, but people who die due to ignorance or due to carelessness of taking some simple measures that would have actually allowed them to live longer. And there's something peculiar about this next chart. It compares the communicable maternal, neonatal, and infectious diseases and also non-communicable diseases and how they lead to death. That death by these factors from 1990 to 2017. If you go through the chart, you can see that there's a decline in the upper part. That's the communicable maternal, neonatal, and infectious diseases. The rate that we are leading to death is actually going down. We can see with that red or orange upper part of the chart. But the second part, the blue part, shows the non-communicable disease. That's the NCDs. We can see that there's a drastic increase over the years from 1990 to 2017. There is a rise in death caused by non-communicable diseases. And what if we want to look critically at that chart, it shows that due to inventions in medicine, you can see that there is a decline in death due to communicable diseases, maternal and neonatal and nutritional disease. But for non-communicable disorders, the chronic diseases, there is a rise in number of deaths coming from these disorders. And that shows that, and this is a graph, this is an area where we can actually work to prevent these chronic disorders, these non-communicable diseases. And that's our role as healthcare professionals, healthcare practitioners, and also even individuals, seeing that, yes, there's a rise in the death caused by non-communicable disease. What can I do? What steps should I take into place right now to ensure that I don't fall into this category, or I don't add to the number that is currently increasing per year? So how do we do this? Because we've been talking about these numbers, talk about these figures. And so right now we are going into areas that we can actually explore to ensure that, yes, we take extra measures to prevent or reduce this debt that results from these risk factors that are shared earlier, and also these disorders that are highly preventable. First is obesity. Obesity comes due to the imbalance between declining energy expenditure due to physical inactivity and high energy in diet. So what does that mean? Person consumes a lot of food, eats a lot of food, consumes a lot of calories, but spend little or no energy per day. There is a declining energy expenditure. There is physical inactivity. Wake up in the morning, enter your car, drive to work, sit on your desk throughout the day, close for work, drive home, sit by the TV, watch TV, go to bed and sleep. Low physical activity, very low. But you see this category of individuals eating junks, eating food, adding to the calories. So there's an imbalance. There is a high intake of calories, but very low burning of such calories that are consumed. And that's what leads majorly to obesity. And increasing physical activity actually helps reduce intake of food. Right. So if you find yourself that you are not physically active, there's a need to also reduce the level of food intake, especially ensuring that there's a balance between the two. And the major important measure to observe this, to weigh this and to measure this, is basically using the BMI, body mass index, and is a measure of the weight to the height of the individual. And if an individual have presents 30 and above, it is seen as being obese. Overweight falls between 25 and 30. So there's a high risk for people that falls even in the overweight region. Though many people don't even give a lot of cognizance to this particular group, but there's high risk, as you can see from the chart. For example, overweight people experience a 2 to 3-fold elevation in the risk of cardiovascular disease and hypertension, and a more than 10-fold increase in the risk of developing type 2 diabetes compared with lean individuals. So that's why it's important to ensure that your BMI falls within the normal range and not overweight or obese. Cardiovascular disorders, diseases, are actually second major cause. They are major killers, as I've shared in the previous chart. It's number one killer in the world, cardiovascular disorders. And this can be easily mentioned and monitored through checking regular checks of the BP, especially if your parents actually happen to be hypertensive. It's very important to be conscious and to check, and to also monitor the diet, because risk of their major forms, heart disease and stroke, is reduced by eating less saturated and trans fat and sufficient amount of N3 and N6 polyunsaturated fats, taking of fruits and vegetables and less salt, as well as physical activity. That's very important. Controlling the weight and staying active physically, taking time to exercise, running weekend, taking time to burn off the accumulated calories and fat that is taken during the week or during the week. And also, it's better to reduce salt intake for this particular category of patient. Thirdly, we have diabetes. Diabetes is one of the major risk factors of diabetes is excess weight gain. Overweight patient, obese patients that are physically inactive, they actually account for the escalating rate of type 2 diabetes worldwide. So if you have tendency to develop diabetes, if it runs in your family, it is essential to maintain normal body weight, reduce your weight as much as possible with respect to your height, maintain a normal BMI or lean BMI, watch your diet, stay physically active. This action, these steps will help to increase your number of days and also improve your quality of life, not resulting in diabetes and having to be placed on drugs for the remaining days of one's life. Thirdly, we have dental diseases too, because these are usually overlooked, but it is important to ensure that one, the teeth are cleaned, they are washed regularly. There's a need to visit the dentist if there are caries already on the teeth. Gingivitis is usually common with caries, so we also expect that with regular visits to the dentist, so that there won't be loss of your teeth. Consuming less sugary food items, and appropriate exposure to fluoride is also very important, because you don't want your teeth to erode due to the content of your meal, because that happens with acidic food. Osteoporosis and bone fracture is also quite common. So it's important as you advance in age, to take adequate calcium. 500 milligrams per day is ideal. And also vitamin D in populations with high osteoporosis rate. It also helps to reduce fracture risk. So as we advance in age, it's good and proper to take calcium supplements and vitamin D. Cancer, that's the next disorder that we will be also looking at. Tobacco is the number one cause of cancer. People smoke for pleasure. They smoke, they consume tobacco. And recently, we have other forms of smoking, shisha, and the rest. People do Indian hemp. And we have lots of young guys involved in this habit. And this habit is killing. This habit, tobacco specifically, leads to lung cancer. And it's one of the if I go back to the slide, it's one of the major preventable killer diseases that we have globally. Many people die globally due to cancer of the lungs, and is the most common form of death coming from cancer. And maintaining a high healthy weight will also help to reduce risk of cancers of the esophagus, colorectum, breast, endometrium, and kidney. Limiting alcohol intake is also very good for the liver. Don't take too much alcohol. It reduces risk cancer of the mouth, throat, esophagus, liver, and the breast. And also ensuring an adequate intake of food. We cannot overflock that. Intake of food or fruits and vegetables should further reduce the risk of oral cavity, esophagus, stomach, and colorectal cancer. So what do we eat? What measures do we take to actually prevent deaths due to preventable disorders? One is to ensure generous consumption of fruits and vegetables. Make it part of your diet. Make it the chunk of your diet that you eat a lot of fruits and vegetables. And also adequate folic acid intake. And also consume more of the cereal products in their whole grain. High fiber form. Consuming grains in high fiber form actually helps. It has double benefit. First, it helps to consequently, one, the consumption of fiber from cereal products has consequently been associated with lower risk of CADs and type 2 diabetes. So people that take a lot of fiber and cereal products, they have less risk of developing cardiovascular disorders and diabetes. And secondly, higher consumption of dietary fiber also appears to help with weight control. So if you find yourself that you always like eating, you like chewing, there's always something to chew, why not spend the time eating fibrous product, high fiber products, because it actually helps with those two benefits that I just shared. It lowers the risk of CADs and type 2 diabetes. And secondly, it helps to facilitate weight control. Very to limit consumption of sugar and sugar, like refined from sugar cane, sugar beets, and high fructose corn sugars. They have no nutritional value. except to add calories. And we have talked about the importance of ensuring that there's a balance between calories accumulation and then the dissipation of these activities, breaking down and using, burning out these calories. So if calories are, if it is broken down, if we have a patient taking a lot of sugary items, adding nutritional value, or just only adding calories, it's going to lead to overweight and obesity is the major risk factor to many of those chronic disorders. Secondly, limit excessive calories intake from any source. I think I shared that also in all my earlier presentation. Thirdly, limit sodium intake. Some people cannot eat without adding lots of salt in their meal. That's why it's important to always add little salt, limit sodium intake, ensure that you are not predisposing your heart to elevated BP or stroke, as the case may be. From this point, I leave you with a quote by Hippocrates that says that let food be thy medicine, and thy medicine shall be thy food. Let food be thy medicine. Thy medicine shall be thy food. So take food as if you are taking the medication. Eat healthy, eat green, eat vegetables, eat lots of fruit. It helps your system. Roger Williams also said that health requires healthy food. So it's important to always remember, one of the takeaways from this meeting is that it's very important to eat healthy, very important to take healthy meals, because your meal can actually be digesting. So what are the other steps that we need to take? I will just quickly round up with that before I turn to Fambete Olalere. Okay. First, do regular screening. Regularly screen yourself. Go for screening. Do blood pressure check. Do diabetes check. Cholesterol check. They are very, very important. You won't know. Some things can start developing without showing symptoms. So it's better to detect early and take measures to prevent deterioration. Secondly, is cancer screening. Most people don't. Some people, they tell you that it cannot happen to me. Scriptures, they quote Quran, they say it's not for me, but it is important and vital to go for regular screening. Make it an annual plan. Go for screening, spend the little money. Some people think that it is more, like I said earlier, it's more expensive to take measures. It's more expensive to take measures than having to treat disorders. But like I said, it is actually more expensive treating disorders, treating already aggravated disorders, than detecting on time, taking measures to ensure that this can be prevented and not lead to disability, death, and chronic disorders. Thirdly, there's need for us to counsel on topics like quitting smoking. People that are already involved in smoking, they've already developed a bad habit of smoking, they're already losing weight, find it difficult losing weight, their eating habit is very terrible, people battling with depression, and so on. So it is very important to take counseling topics for these particular kind of people that are already alcohol addicts, to take measures of breaking these habits and reducing their exposure to these triggers, to these important risk factors. Fourthly, go for regular baby and child visit. Check your baby. If your child is constantly complaining of constant fatigue, it may just not be malaria. Everybody treats malaria in Nigeria. It can be any other disorder, and it's better to know on time and quickly handle and treat such development before it gets worse. And also, routine vaccination is very, very important. Take vaccination against some common communicable disorders, measles for children. Some things are even very important. Take polio vaccination, meningitis, measles, and for adults too. If you take like HPV vaccine, take hepatitis B vaccines, take all the vaccines that is possible, and ensure that, yes, you are immune, you are fortified against further or subsequent exposure to those disease-causing agents. And lastly, counseling, screening, and vaccination to ensure healthy pregnancy. So for pregnant women too, it's important to go for screening, check development of the fetus, and take vaccines as needed. So those are some of the steps, and it doesn't end there. So how do we do this regular screening? I've already talked about doing blood pressure, diabetes, and cholesterol tests. Very important. Do it regularly. If you are predisposed to, if you have the likelihood of developing it due to genetic makeup, check your blood pressure regularly, and also do the diabetes test and cholesterol test regularly. Cancer screening should involve mammograms, colonoscopy. We recently heard about our Wakanda King that we recently lost to cancer. That's why it's important to go for screening. These things are not far away from us. We have people dying from cancer. They are around us. And that's why, even though we don't want it, but nothing stops us from doing from regular checks. Do those regular checks and ensure that, yes, you are free. You don't have them. And thirdly, depression. We don't talk a lot about this too in our environment, but some people are depressed. They are in severe sad conditions, and it's already affecting them mentally. So there's a need to also go for checks. If people are already experiencing the symptoms, they have to check STDs, HIV, chlamydia. Go for checks. Osteoporosis is also important to check. My time is running. I need to run and give Betty some time. In conclusion, other measures to take to prevent disability. And I mentioned earlier that we prevent 3Ds. Preventive medicine, the goal is to prevent, improve our health condition, improve our well-being, and ensure that we prevent disability, diseases, and death. So one of the ways is for the government to introduce speed limits. That's also very important to help the population, ensuring that, yes, they are controlled, even if they want to be controlled. For individuals to drive responsibly, observe speed limit when they need to observe speed limit, and even do regular checks on your vehicles. It's very important so that you won't get involved in auto crash leading to disability, something that are highly preventable. And also, you work in a place, you are exposed to chemicals, you are exposed to any form of hazard, take preventive measures. Use gadgets, use PPEs. For health workers, always ensure that you use your PPEs. Protect yourself from any form of infection that is possible. So that's how I will end my presentation today. I want to thank you for giving me this audience, and I hope that you have been able to pick one or two things from my presentation today. So at this point, I will hand you over to Fam Betty or Don Ayo. I'm pleased to have today co-facilitating with me. So from Betty, I can already see you.
Okay, good morning once again, everybody. My name is Dr. Betty Olaleye. I'm a pharmacist, a public health professional, and I'm also a family planning consultant and also an entrepreneur. I want to appreciate my colleague Fama King. He has indeed done justice to the topic. He has talked about the theory aspects of preventive medicine, how we'll be handling the practical aspects, and sharing some experience with us. I'm sure we all used to the saying, is prevention better than cure? But I'm going to ask you, really, is prevention really better than cure? Some of us will say, yes, prevention is better than cure. But public health advocate argues that prevention is cheaper than cure. And my training today will focus on how. The question is how. How is preventive medicine cheaper than cure? As a community pharmacist and a public health professional who specialize in preventive medicine, my topic today will focus on the how. My colleague, Pharma King, has mentioned about examples of preventive medicine and what preventive medicine is all about. I'm not really going to bore you with that topic again. I will just mention some of the examples he has listed, and I will tell you how it is actually cheaper to go for preventive medicine than looking for a cure for AIDS. one of the examples of preventive medicine he mentioned is immunization. Immunization simply means administration of vaccines against poliovirus to prevent inflammation of the liver, against yellow fever, against measles and the rest. We won't really appreciate the benefits of this until we live with people or we know people living with all this disease. For example, a patient living with poliomyelitis, you can look at the picture below, you see all these kids living with it. You can imagine the psychological effects, the stress the parents will be passing through, the amount of money they will even spend in taking care of them. You can imagine people living with hepatitis, you can imagine the amount of money they spend on their drugs. You can imagine the burden and the liabilities they have on their partners or their loved ones. So it's actually very essential we prevent ourselves against this instead of having to live with them or to start looking for means to start taking care of them. I remember when I was a field as a WHO supervisor on eradication of polio, we got to a particular place and the woman was insisting that she doesn't want us to administer the vaccine to the child. I have to bring out this picture here and show it to her and tell her, how will you feel if your child end up being like this? What is going to be the effect of the child? Even you as a mother, that will have to be carrying her every now and then. So at last, she allowed us to administer that vaccine to the child. So you can imagine the people, this kind of stress, the kind of life they'll be passing through. And obviously these things are things that can actually be prevented. We don't really have to pass through all these. They are things that can be prevented. And recently I was reading about, I think August 25, when African region was certified white poliovirus free by WHO. That was a very good one. We are looking forward to immunization or vaccines for coronavirus too. And as of yesterday, I think I heard there was one that just came in. So that was a good one. So most important thing is important will prevent all these things than having have to live with them and spending a lot of money on them. Another one is contraception. As I said earlier on, I'm a family planning consultant. When it comes to family planning, is an area that I'm very passionate about, an area that I can always keep talking about. The truth is, it's actually very cheaper. In fact, it's one of the cheapest preventive medicine than having to deal with complications from unwanted pregnancy or unplanned pregnancy, or complications that has to do with issues with abortions. This year alone, I've lost loved ones to unplanned pregnancy, which is very painful, something that could have been prevented. How much is contraceptions now? And if you see people now, the rate of fertility cases we have was majorly due to, abortion, complications from abortions. So it's actually cheaper and easier to actually treat all these things than having to live with them and to regret it all the rest of our lives, or having to lose our loved ones on diseases or issues that can be prevented. Then another example is lifestyle modification. My colleague, Ms. Farmakin, has said a lot about lifestyle modification, exercise, balanced diet, rest. But I want us to know that to prevent chronic heart diseases like blood pressure, diabetes, obesity, exercise is very, very important. Exercise allows blood to flow freely in our body. And it's also very important when you wake up in the morning and, you know, do a little exercise to allow your bones and everything to be flexible. I tell people you don't really have to start running up and down and start doing things that are very stressful before you say you've done an exercise. Morning, do a little exercise around the house. You can decide to jog around the house. You can buy a skipping rope and, you know, do and skip. If you do 50 today, increase it to 100 tomorrow. There are lots of things we can do inside our room, like press up or so many exercise. Then balanced diet. Balanced diet is also another very important area. All these lifestyle modifications are very cheap. There are some things we can do instead of having to start spending a lot of money to take care of diabetes, to take care of so many chronic diseases. Then for balanced diet, I tell people, when you ask them questions, do you take balanced diet? You hear them telling you yes. Okay, ask them, what did you eat today or yesterday? They'll tell you they ate yam and egg in the morning. They'll be feeling one thing. They ate yam and egg in the morning. In the afternoon, they took rice. In the night, they ate tamala. Please tell me, is it not still the same? Is it not still the same category of food, carbohydrates? So when we talk about balanced diets, we talk about 50% whole grains. We talk about 35% fruits and vegetables. We talk about 50% protein. We talk about 5% carbohydrates. That is what our meal should contain every day. And 50% of grains basically has to do with wheat, has to do with oat series, has to do with brown rice, which is a fodder rice. So these are the things we need to eat often. And even our fruits and vegetables, the body needs 35% of it every day. It's very important. Then another lifestyle modification that is also very essential is rest. My colleague Famake was talking about depression the other time, was talking about stress. We stress ourselves too much in this country. You see people leaving their house as early as 6 a.m. and not coming back home until 11 p.m. or 12 p.m. No time to rest, no time to take a break. So tell me, please, how would your body be stressed out? How would you burn out? How will you get sick? How would you develop diseases and chronic infections that can actually be prevented? We all need a break. We all need to rest. And I tell people, how do you take rest? Depending on your nature of job, some of you might just take 1 hour or 30 minutes break at work. And some might take a day off. Some might decide to take some week off. Rest is actually important because that is the only time you can meditate. If you don't even meditate, how do you think about your life? How do you think about your goals? How do you think about the things you've set up for yourself? So rest is very, very essential. And for you to take your rest, you need to take a break, as I've said, one, so that you can be able to meditate on the next objective, on the next goals. Another thing is you need to talk to people that are professionals on that your feed, so that you reduce your stress. Some of us just feel like, I want to be a champion on this. Someone has been there before you. That's the truth. So you communicate with people that are ahead of you, like your mentors on this job, so that they can make the job very easy for you. Then another thing is talk to God. I'm not trying to be Christian or holy woman here, but the truth is God is only God that makes things very easy for us, you know? So talk to him, and you can only do this during your time of maybe exercise. For like me, I use my time of exercise to meditate a lot. So you the ideas and so many things will start coming. So that by the time you get to the job, you are fully prepared for that day and not overworking and stressing yourself. And at the end of the day, you fall into sickness or into depression. Then another important point is screening tests and regular health checks, especially against cancer, for you to determine your BP, against cholesterol level, against diabetes and high test. So it's also very essential we go for all these regular health checks. If you don't go for regular health checks, you don't know, most people don't even know if they have BP, their blood pressure is high. Most of them don't even know. Most people you see coming down with cancer and a lot of different diseases, it's because they didn't go for regular checkups. If you go for regular checkups, they detect on time and you'll be able to treat it earlier. So as I've said, the purpose of preventive medicine is early detection and also prevention of potential health problem or diseases. And at the end of the day, these things are actually easier and they are cheaper to treat. So as I've said, it's actually important that we know that preventive medicine are actually cheaper to treat. Then another point we need to know is, I'm going to share with us some cases based on my experience on my job. One thing is, it is important for us to know that in order to live long, preventive medicine is very important. Again, I'm going to repeat this. In order to live long, preventive medicine is very important. I don't know if you have seen my slide now, but it's important that these three points are very, very essential. If that is the only point you are going to go home with today, please, it is very important. Case studies on preventive medicine. So as I've said, one, it is important to know that in order to live long, preventive medicine is very important. I remember a case of a woman that walked into my premises and came with her daughter of 13 years old. She actually didn't come to lodge complaint. She just asked for a particular brand of anti-malaria. But looking at the daughter, I noticed she wasn't feeling too fine, feeling too well. She was looking weak. And I asked the mother, why don't you run a test for this child instead of going for this brand of anti-malaria? Because for us at Tiske Pharmacy, we have a laboratory where we make sure we ensure proper diagnosis before treatment. So she said no. She has been treating her for the past 13 years. Anytime she comes down with sickness like this, she knows what to give and the rest, okay? You know, most of them, when you start telling them to go for tests, they believe you want to take more of their money. So, but I remember telling her, if she doesn't feel better after 3 days, please take her to the hospital. So a week after, I saw them rush in. At this stage, the lady could not even walk herself again. Her sister was holding her. So the mother was shouting, okay, what test do you want me to do the other time? Let me go for the test. I wrote the test for her. She went for the screening. By the time the results came out, the malaria parasite was high. To be precise, 3+. Then even the full blood count, all the parameters were high, including white blood cells. At this level, there's nothing I could do. I have to refer them to the hospital and try to follow up on them. 2 weeks after, unfortunately, we lost this girl to chronic meningitis, something that could have been prevented. At the end of the day, they end up spending more the money she didn't want to spend, and she spent more, and they still lost the lady. So as I said, in order for us to prevent long life, in order for us to prevent sudden death, preventive medicine is very important. Another point we need to know is that in order to prevent disease, infections, sickness, and disabilities, preventive medicine is essential. I also remember the case of a man that came into the premises with a wife. Because as I said, for us, every Wednesday, we declare it's regular checkup free for our patients or our customers. So they come in to check their BP and the rest. So the man came with the wife. The wife is actually our patient. She's controlling the BP, and the BP is well controlled. She told the husband then, "Oni, why don't you come to check your BP? Actually, it's free. They do it free." The man was like, "No, I'm not interested. I don't even want to know. You know, people believe in what I don't know will not kill me." So he said he's not interested because he doesn't even want to know. And you know, men, it was like he has an herb he's using. Even if anything happened to him, the herb will take care of it. In Yoruba, they call it agbo. So the guys, they have lots of herbs and the rest that they use. So they left that day. But a week after, the lady came again with the husband. At this time, I was like, okay, let me just intervene. And I told the husband, why don't you just look at it? It's free. We are not collecting money from you. But he was like, no, he's not interested. Okay, so I left there. A few seconds to that, I heard a very loud sound at the entrance of the pharmacy. By the time we rushed there, we met this man on the floor with symptoms of stroke already. Suddenly, he could not talk again. He could not lift up his hand. He could not lift up the leg. The wife was shouting. They told you to check your BP, but you refused. Madam, what can you do? I was like, there's nothing I can do at this point. You have to refer him. So I followed on them again as usual. And up to today, the man is still living with that disability. And not the disability alone, but even with the diseases. He's still treating symptom of stroke, and he's still managing the BP up to now. So as I've said, something that could have been prevented. And now he has to live with that disability for the rest of his life. Another point is, in order for us to enjoy our seed and our future, preventive medicine is paramount. So as I've said, these points are very, very important. The truth is, if you don't want to become a liability and become a burden to your loved ones, you need to take care of yourself. I remember the case of a woman too that was locked in a room by her children. Why? Because they said she has become a burden to them due to amputation from chronic diabetes. They spend a lot of money on her, and now they are praying for her to die so that they can have peace. It's sad, but that's the reality. It will get to a point in life that people taking care of you will get tired of it, and they will be praying for you to die. So if you want to enjoy your future, if you want to enjoy your seed, if you want to enjoy all this work that we are talking about, you need to take your health very paramount. You need to take it very, very important. If not, your people will pray for you to die so that they can have peace. So as I've said alone, people also think that they cannot come down with all these health problems we are talking about. You hear people telling you they can never come down with BP. In my family, we don't nurse that. They will tell you they can never come down with diabetes. But the truth is, there are life-threatening cases that we should be bothered about. There are cases such as low BP, low sugar, and even low PCV. So our concern should not be about high all the time, maybe high BP and the rest. But there are also life-threatening cases we should be worried about, like low BP, low PCV, and low sugar. I also remember the case of a woman that came in and said she has treated malaria, treated typhoid, but she's not still feeling better. As usual, we told her to go to run a test. And when the result came out, the parameters were all good. Even the malaria was really negative. But the BP was low and the PCV was low. She was treated accordingly. And a few days after, she was feeling good. So, but I know cases of people that we've lost to PCV and low PCV. Even one of my neighbors died recently because of low BP. So we should not be thinking everything is about I can never have it. I can never do this. We should be worried about other cases that can actually be a problem, okay? So the hard truth is that preventive medicine can be the difference between life and death. There's a very thin line between life and death, and preventive medicine can just make the difference between them. So we actually need to take care of this. And I noticed that during our community outreach, there's a high level of awareness of preventive medicine, but a very low prevalence was observed in practice. So we realize that it's not as if people don't know that there's something called they're supposed to go for BP check, they're supposed to go for screening tests, but in reality, people don't really observe it. So I want to encourage us as health professionals, as health workers, that we should go for routine checks. So what do we need to do as health workers and professionals? We need to encourage routine health checks. As I said, for T-Scare Pharmacy, we do this every week. That is every Wednesday, we make sure it's free for everybody to come for their routine check. We also need to encourage monthly programs on preventive medicine. So every month, we also run different programs of preventive medicine in our premises. We also do quarterly community health outreach. So we make sure we go to the communities and go with all our preventive measures and make sure that people come out and you encourage them. By the time they see their results, they'll be encouraged to go for treatment. So as I've said, the goal of preventive medicine is to promote well-being and to prevent diseases, disability, and death. So it's the responsibility of every health professionals to make sure that we all encourage our people. And it's our responsibility to make sure we prevent deaths, has to do with diseases and infections and the rest. And also, what for me today, I want to ask you, do you know your health status? Most of us don't even know. If I ask you when last did you check your BP, some of them don't even know. If I ask you when last did you go for a routine checkup, they will not even know. So please, immediately after this program, you do me a favor, just go and check and make sure you know your health status. Go for the routine ones. Take care of your health. It is your priority. Take care of your health. It is your future. Your health is your future. It is your wealth. And it is a must. Thank you for listening to me. So if there's any question, let us know. Over to Farmer King.
Thanks a lot for Betty Odu and your Lolly. We are really glad to have you around today. The angle you took it from, very practical angle. Then there's a question for you actually waiting. So before I go to the question, I would like to encourage everybody. Want to appreciate you. Thanks for joining us today. We're really glad you joined. Without you joining, it would have been boring. So it was really good having everybody to participate today. So it's your turn to talk. We have done little talking. So I want to give you some opportunity to ask your questions. So if you have any question, you can use the chat bot to ask your question. Do we want to allow them talk? No, I think they just welcome questions through the chat. I already have one question already from Sam. Okay, the first question says that how can we implement preventive medicine for our patients? I think I would read that to Fam Betty.
Okay, so as I've said, for us at CSK Pharmacy, every one of us as ex-professionals, we should have what we call a point of care where we can put our BP machines, our equipment that they use in checking diabetes, and even lifestyle modification is part of our duty as health professionals to encourage our customers or our patients. Once anybody comes in to complain, for us at this care, once anybody comes in to complain, the first thing is we ask you to sit down and check your BP. Because you might be surprised that is even where you get to the root of what is happening to the person. So when people come into lodge complaint, you don't just go straight and just assume you know what is happening to them. So you ask them to sit down, you check their BP, even if the BP is okay. If you have, as I said, there are points of care where you can check for malaria, where you can check for people's diabetes, for sugar, and so many other things. There are lots of points of care, that equipment that you can get. At least to make sure that you know what you are treating before you just prescribe. I tell my people that it's not always advisable to treat people according to their symptoms. There's what we call balance and check. Even with the symptoms, you already know, okay, if I ask the person to go for this test, then it's also going to help me with my treatment. So please, it's very essential for every one of us as health professionals to have a point of care at our place of practice to ensure that, okay, you know what you are doing and you get a proper diagnosis before treatments. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm still waiting for more questions, but while that is going on, we encourage our participants to click on that form I just shared. You would like to have topics, you have to share with us what you'd like us to talk about. The topics you want us to talk about, please just feel free. Drop your comments in that form so that we will be able to allow you to give us feedback. Let us hear from you what you want us to talk about next time subsequently. This program runs monthly. We run this webinar monthly, usually comes on the last Saturdays of the month. Well, for today, we actually pushed it to the first Saturday of September because the one for last week, which was meant for August, couldn't hold for some reason or the other. So we apologize for that. So subsequently, looking forward, you can always join us last Saturday of the month for this awesome time where we issues that relates to our practice, either at an hospital, a retail pharmacy, or wherever you practice as a medical practitioner. And as the case may be true, maybe you are just an individual interested in your health and your well-being, this is a place to be. Join us every month at the end of the month, last Saturday, and learn. Let us learn together. So I wait for more questions before we round off for today. Thank you, Supermax. Nice having you. So any question, if you have, please, I can see somebody to type in. I'll wait for that to come in. Or should we allow people talk? Maybe we do that. Okay.
Okay.
I think you can, if you want to ask your question, you can do right now by indicating interest to, and you'll be allowed. Okay, I think somebody dropped a comment. Can you give us a practical example of balanced diet? Most of us, usual or sometimes unconsciously, just eat what we have. The balanced diet. Okay. I think the question is trying to find out from, it wants us to give a practical example of a balanced diet. Most of
Okay. Yeah, I can take that. As I said, lifestyle modification is also one aspect that will do a lot, especially when it comes to balance. I was trying to rush because of my time. So for balanced diet, as I've said, whatever food you are eating in a day, make sure you have 50% of all grains in it. Make sure you have 35% of fruits and vegetables. Make sure you have 15% protein and a 5% carbohydrate. That makes a balanced diet in a day. I'm going to cite an example. In porridge, using porridge as an example, you can use cocoyam. I told you cocoyam is part of all grains. So put your cocoyam there. It has given you your 50%. You put your vegetables and whatever fruit inside again. That is your 35%. You can add your plantain. Plantain is also around 15% proteinous. Then you can decide to add yam or whatever in carbohydrates. So that means in porridge food alone, with all these things I've mentioned, while eating your porridge, you already have a balanced diet in it. But if you don't want to do that, if you take whatever you take in the morning, either you take bread and egg, just know that your bread is 5%, your egg is 15%. In the afternoon, you might decide to take your fruits and vegetable. You already have your 35%. At night, you might decide to take your brown rice, which is your father rice, or your oats, which is already 50%. So which means in a day, you are already having a balanced diet. And another thing I will mention that is very important is when it comes to fruits and vegetables. You know, when you talk about fruits and vegetables, people will tell you, yes, I eat fruits every day. If you ask them, okay, how many did you take? I took vegetable, I took orange, I have this. We are talking about 35%. Your 35%, you might not get it in just one banana or fruit alone. And that is why most time we talk about supplements. In your supplement, you see so many vitamins and minerals there. So even if you don't have time or you don't get enough fruits and vegetables, once you take your supplements in a day, it has covered for your 35% fruits and vegetables. So please, balanced diet is actually very important. I know most of us don't really do a lot of whole grains. So now you know. So take more of your oats. I'm sure most of us know about our oat series. Take more of it. Take more of your fada rice. Then just add it to it. So in a day, just make sure you balance your diet. And not about rice and eba every time. And when it comes to balanced diet, again, another thing is people eat very late. You know, you see people going home around 10 p.m. and they'll put a plate of amala and a plate of eba in their front. You eat it and you go to bed immediately. That's why you see most of them rolling on bed. They can't even sleep overnight. You understand what I'm saying? So please, even if you know you're going to eat your carbohydrates very late, just make sure you take it before 7 p.m. You understand? So please, balance diet is very important. I hope you get that point. Okay.
Okay, thank you for Betty. I think you have broken it down a bit, and I also heard that it's good to take supplements too. Not supplements to your diet. Supplements are good. They are good extra additional sources of nutrients and minerals that may be scarce even in your diet. Okay, I think we have some questions right now. Okay, I think this from okay. Thank you, Petley, for that question. Now, Romeo, in some cases, do you give injection to patients? You are doing a good job. Okay. I think that's for you.
Yes.
Everybody's asking you. Okay,
for anything that has to do with preventive medicine, collaboration is very, very important. We actually give injection, but we have to collaborate with other health professionals. Because for us as pharmacists, we are not allowed to inject. So because of that, we collaborate with community health workers. Because of the routine stuff we do immunization at my center, we do a lot of things, family planning, you know, we do a lot of public health services. So we don't have choice but to collaborate with people that will inject. So to that question, I will tell you yes, but we have professionals that will do it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Someone asks, Wally asks that, can we have access to repeat of this training? Yes. You have it. We actually share this this recording of this webinar after the event. So I hope you registered with us. So if you are registered with us and you have your email, you will get the link to download the recorded version. Okay, Sam from Betty, can we refer our patients to your lab?
Of course, yes. We actually have a standard laboratory. You know, we run virtually all diagnostic tests. I don't know the one you come that you won't meet. Even, what's it called, scan? Then, in fact, virtually all, so you can refer, yes.
Okay. Yeah, Dr. Babs, can you list these routine checks? Interesting. I think I shared something similar.
You should answer that.
Yeah, okay. I think I shared. Let me just go through it too. I like to use so that we see. I shared it on my slide. Okay. The basic ones: hypertension, diabetes for patients with. Can you see my slide? Can you see the slide?
Not yet.
Okay. I hope it's low sometime. Okay. Well, if we turn low, let me just talk about it. Blood pressure, very important. Routine checks, diabetes, cholesterol test, cancer screening, like mammograms, colonoscopies. Also very important. I also mentioned level of depression. Can also check that. For STDs, it's also important to check, especially for patients, for people that they have multiple partners. It's good to check that also periodically. And another one I also quoted here is osteoporosis. Check your bone texture. It's really important to... Can we see the slide now? It's not showing. Let me just go. Can we see the slide?
Not yet.
Okay. So, same if you don't see, let me just stay with. Check for BP, check for diabetes, check for STDs, possible STDs. Also, check for cholesterol. And I didn't mention cholesterol. Add cholesterol to the blood pressure and diabetes. Cancer screenings, which most people don't do. Go for cancer screenings, STDs. Bone textures. Yeah, those are the ones I listed, except we will have more.
Okay, so let me just add to it. Okay, so for regular health check and screening tests, I'm sure most people, when you walk into a laboratory or even to any pharmacy around and you tell them you want them to do the regular routine health checks for you, it's already listed somewhere that they all know, at least the major and the basics one. So as we've mentioned, BP is very important. We even have eye tests. In fact, there are lists that they wrote there. Once you walk in and tell people that I just want to run a screening test, the normal routine one or the regular one. So they will run it for you for any standard laboratory or any standard pharmacy. It's there.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I can't read this. Can you help me read the next question? My system is hanging. That's why you can't see the screen.
Okay, so from Balogun, he said, if perhaps after a routine check, drugs were prescribed and the patient started accordingly, but eventually missed a dose, what should I do if I miss a dose? Okay, so let me take that. The truth is, before we prescribe or hand over any medication to you, we advise you to make sure you don't skip a dose. But peradventure, it's happened, we just tell you to, immediately you remember, just make sure you use it. We don't advise anybody, we don't want anybody to miss their dose because of, what's it called now? Oh, sorry, it's not coming to my head. Because of, oh my God. Okay, so please, whatever the case is, we don't advise anybody to skip their dose. And immediately you remember, please just take it immediately. All right.
Okay.
So.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think we need to round up now. We have actually gone beyond our time. So thank you for joining, everybody. We really appreciate your time. We look forward to the next session holding next, let me check the date. That will be the last Saturday of September. So we will go through your topics that you suggested. We'll come up with another interesting topic that we'll share on that day. So last Saturday of the month, we'll be having the next webinar. So we'll also look forward to having you. And also, please, if you have not dropped your topic, please kindly do. There's a link just on the chat box. Just click on that link. Give us a good feedback. Let us hear from you. Let's know what you feel about what you've heard so far and also the topic you want us to talk about. Thank you for joining. I want to give a special appreciation to Betty Odwayo for joining us today. You have done a good job. And hopefully we'll like to have you one day again. Thanks a lot. Thank you, everybody. Have an awesome week. Weekend. Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.